you find your shape, or does your shape find you?
Very good, interesting question, yeah. I think it's both, actually. There are stories that people have gone to someone and they've said, you know, and they've traveled like to some other country and they've said, no, no, I'm not your sheikh. Your sheikh's in like this other country. And so, you know, usually amongst them they know who their students are. And the point about this book is it's not a who's who. There's no way I could, it wouldn't be the same book. This is just my journey. Any one of you, if you went on this journey, would meet different people. It's like doctors, you know, all doctors are different, they have certain specialities that they deal with, certain illnesses. And that's what the shayukh are like. Sheikh Muhammad Habib used to say the whole world is a hospital, and the shayukh and the salihin are the doctors and the nurses. Because we all have illnesses of the heart, and that's why we need their help. But as I said, it's not a who's who, it's really just my journey and what happened about when I met them. And really, I just wanted to share it because this time, with all this, what's going on in the world, something's not working. And part of the problem is that these people have been forgotten. And even England, there's an island off of England in North Wales where there's buried 25,000 Christian saints. And a friend of mine lives up there. And I was telling him, he said, yeah, I can see it from my house. He lives right near there. So we forget that, you know, England was a very, there were a lot of saints in England. And then, you know, we had these, the Catholic times, and then the Protestants came in and destroyed all the tombs and destroyed all these places. And it's the same old story, you know. But all of us are on a journey, and all of us are looking for signposts to how to get to God. And really, these people are signposts. They're not God, but they are indicators, of, you know, they can help us in our journey. Ibn Battuta, whenever he traveled around the world, always used to seek these people out, you know, and ask for their prayers and things. So I tried to do the same as that, you know.
Okay, right, a few hands going up now. And if I go to the gentleman in the pink shirt there, and then the gentleman down here, so if we take a couple of questions at a time.
Thank you very much for the presentation. Very, very interesting. I like the way you've managed to capture the sort of ethereal nature of the being, if you like. So they very much come across as vessels rather than people who are invested on the earth, which is a big point and very difficult to capture.
Yeah.
The question is, from this journey, are there central themes that you think we can apply to those of us who are not able to disconnect from our function or our actions in this world to such a degree, so that we can be on that same path, if you like, but still fulfill what we think our life goal is?
Yeah, that's a very important.
Just want to ask you a question as well.
How did you find these people and how did you gain their audience?
Okay. I'll answer that question first. I'm someone who lives on their instincts. So a lot of people I met from travelling, sometimes I might hear about somebody. Like when Sheikh Hamza said to me, I want you to come to Mauritania and photograph my sheikh. And he showed me this really bad video. I mean, it was so bad. Even within that, I could tell that that was someone I had to go and photograph. So it's really like instinct. Because for me, there had to be a connection. Otherwise, it wouldn't work. And there had to be some exchange between the two of us. And as I said, many of them had never been photographed before. And that was always a challenge, to get their confidence, to trust that I wasn't out to harm them, that I really did respect them. And you know, I'm grateful that they allowed me to photograph them, because otherwise I wouldn't be able to show this. And as far as I know, this has never been done. There's been books written about saints, but there's never been a document. And whether the same document could be done now, I mean, we're into a whole other world. The world is changing again. So maybe these forms of these enlightened beings will change again. This is very much in the format of Islam. But there always have been saintly people. God has always sent enlightened people for us, if you're seeking them out. So it's part of creation, and there always will be these people around until the end of time. What we gain from them, there are many common things. One thing you always feel in their company is that we are all connected. You don't feel separate in their company. They make you feel that we're all part of something. We're all joined. Whether you're Muslim or Christian, it doesn't matter. We're all human beings. And the second thing is that they never judge you. Never ever make a judgment about you. They see you, and they see you at a certain spiritual point on your journey. And they know where you are on that journey, and they make prayers for you, and that's it. When I met Sheikh Murabba Tahaj, it took me 24 hours to get there. I don't speak Arabic. I was brought into his company, I was introduced to him. He said, what's his name? He said, Peter Sanders, you know, Abdul-Adim Sanders. He went, who? They repeated it, and like he went, you know, like the CIA would go into the main to check me out. He went somewhere and unseen, he went, nah. Then he prayed, like made this prayer for my continued happiness and everything. And that was it, that was the end of the transaction. The rest of the time I just spent there watching him and what was going on there. That's all it takes, really, it's simple. So simple things like that. Other universal messages are that we do not resolve differences by violence. How come the world resolves everything by violence? We can sit down and talk, even if we don't agree, we can agree to disagree. All the Prophet ﷺ ever tried to do was to bring people together. That was his role always, he would do anything to avoid conflict. How come that got forgotten? So these very simple things, messages that we really need to embrace as a community. Because if you sit down with other people, you find they want the same thing. And we shouldn't be people who think we're better than others. We're not, we're all the same. No one's better than anybody else. We all make choices. This is a world of choices. Really, I really believe that. I've learned that. God created a world full of complete choice. You have free choice to do whatever you want. You have choice to destroy yourself if you want to. That's your choice. Because that's the way God created creation. He could force us to do things. That's not his nature. Because everything is from love and from mercy. So therefore, why do people think that if you don't do something, he's going to destroy you? What kind of God is that? What kind of God do they believe in? I don't believe in that God. And we shouldn't either. So these are things you learn from sitting with these people. Sometimes I would sit with these great people, they would just talk about very mundane things. But there's something else going on when you're sitting with them. and that's what's really interesting. So you have to kind of be awake when you're sitting with them. I don't know if it answered it. That's a big question, and each person will learn different things from them.
Okay, and there's a lady down here in the black head scarf and the gentleman sort of on the aisle and down the jacket. Thank you.
You had mentioned that you met a lot of luminaries at the time of 70 and 71. Is there any reason, maybe that the light was being given towards you so you could pick up from there?
I mean, the first
in that Hajj, you met so many people, you mentioned.
Yeah, when I first did the Hajj, yes.
Yes.
And then I went to Morocco and I was with Sheikh Mohammed Nabib. So, I think that was the end of something, because he was there with all his followers living. And so I was immersed in that whole kind of community of people. You don't find so many examples of that now. So, you know, you find different Shayukh and saints, and they have people around them, but not to the extent that Sheikh Mohammed Habib I didn't meet. So yeah, I was blessed with that very early. But I've continued looking for those people. And you know, the real mountains are not, they're not, you don't find them all the time. The great, great mountains are quite rare. But the point is that there are other people, hidden people, who still, you know, have a lot to give us and share with us. So.
Did you find that there was a certain common thread, a certain common quality about all these saints and
Well, they're all very beautiful. I mean, I guess they're all from the light of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I mean, they all have this beauty, you know, and you just feel so at ease with them. You know, they never feel you're being judged, you never feel you're being criticized. It was always very merciful and compassionate. They tend to look at creation with great mercy and compassion. And I think that's what sets them apart. They really see that we are all very connected. You can see it in their. I mean, I just like looking at their faces. I mean, it's just, if I'm feeling a bit miserable or something, I just look at their faces and, okay, yeah, life's worth living again.
So the gentleman at the, gentleman on the island there, and then the gentleman down here in the green shirt. Yeah.
I'm just curious about your frequent use of the term saints.
Yes.
And you also use the term shuruk or sheikhs. Of course, in the Catholic faith, as you know, sainthood involves the valediction by the Pope.
Yes.
Are you using those terms interchangeably? What do you mean by saints in Islam, essentially?
Well, we don't have that. We don't have that. I have to go through that authority. Someone is a saint. And this has been part of a problem for me in doing this book, because it looks like I'm saying I'm an authority on these people. I'm not. I'm saying that when I met them, something happened that indicated to me that they had some spiritual enlightenment, and someone else might meet them and not, that thing might not happen. It's really about what happened when I met them, and I've kind of tried to use as many words as possible, because saints, sages, sheikhs, scholars, gurus, I mean, in every religion they have a different word for this thing. But they're all ultimately teachers, and that's a relationship. I don't know how to explain it any more than that. Someone did challenge me on this, saying, are you trying to canonize these people? I'm not, because I'm not in any authority on this subject. But in each meeting, something happened. And there are many I haven't included in this book, because I met some people and it was just a nice transaction, but nothing happened that for me was a spiritual, something that inspired me or showed some light on some problem I was having or something. So it's not, I'm not saying this isn't, these are all, some of them are known by many, many people. Some I met just, I had an individual meeting with them and I felt that they were somebody special. God knows best, really. The idea is just to be looking out for them, because the thing is, you never know when you might meet one. Because we tend to be individuals who are doing things instead of individuals who are beings. You know, we're actually created human beings, but most of the time we're humans doing things. And we get very called out, especially in these societies. We're very busy all the time. And that's when you miss meetings. Someone might say something to you, and afterwards you might think, I should have engaged with that person. So it's just learning, in Dubai they have a minister of happiness. I just found out. Well, the Shayukh and the saints, they're our ministers of happiness. And now in Dubai they have the buildings of mindfulness, which are meant to be our mosques or our zawiyas. So, I mean, whatever language you use, everyone's trying to get to the same place.
Have you ever found some moments in these journeys, in this nobleman's presence, that you don't want to photograph? Or you just want to be in that moment, in this presence, just to have more connection directly.
A woman, you said?
No.
Oh.
A moment.
Have you ever found this moment that you don't want to photograph, you just want it to be?
No, because I'm on a mission, this is my job.
So you've always carried that passion with you?
I had to, because if I didn't do it, who was going to do it? You know, many of these have never been photographed before. Of course, taking the picture is like one moment. Once that's out of the way, I can just sit and be in that company. But I thought you said a woman, because actually in Lamo, after they have the Mao lit, and you know, East Africa is quite a kind of patriarchal society. After the Mao lit, the great granddaughter of Habib Sali, who's buried, the big saint who's buried on Lamo Island, all the scholars in the show go and kiss the hand of his granddaughter. And I wish I could have photographed her. She was just so amazing. But I knew that, you know, everyone would pass out for some bring a camera, so I never got to photograph.
So basically, what I'm trying to say is that today there are many tariqas, there are many shuyukhs,
yes,
and the sincere followers. Even when they meet with their masters, even before looking to these shuyukhs' eyes, they simply pick up their phones and they are trying to picture these moments.
Yeah, no, you can't. You have to know them first.
You mean to sort of build that trust?
Many of these I had to sit and go through a meal and everything, and it was a long process, you know, to get them to agree to be photographed. Because they were sussing me out, they were checking me out. You know, and quite a few times one man said no, when I asked him, he said no. But then he said, let's have some food. And I could tell that he was like, so he said, what would be the point? And I explained to him that, you know, your students would like to have a picture of you and everything. And so after a while, after we finished the meal, he said, you can take my picture if I can give you something. I said, well, that's, I went on two counts, not just one. He said, you can take my picture if I can give you my weird litany, you know, prayers to recite every day. I said, yeah, Bismillah. And then he, you know, he did the picture. And then I gave him the pictures, he was so happy with them. He said, I want to do another picture with my sword this time. So it's not, I'm well aware that the outward form of these people is a distraction. And that's part of the challenge of doing this book, because no matter how beautiful they are, their inside is even better. And the outward form can always be a distraction. But for some reason, this is something I embarked on. I don't know why I was given this job. I'm still trying to work it out. And now we're at the stage now, I've done this for 45 years. I now have to produce the book, which is why we did the campaign to raise the money. I don't know how much money it's going to do, and I'm trying to get, I really want to get one of the top publishers to do it if they have the courage to take this book on. I think it's an important book, not for just the Muslims, but for the whole world. Because saints in Islam were never heard of. The extremists dominate the whole conversation in Islam. And, you know, these people need to be recognized. And so if they publish it, we will get world distribution, which is what I want. So we won't make money. I never did this project for money. The whole point is for this to get out and for people to see these people and know that they exist, and to remind people that there are saints in every religion. There are God's people everywhere. And that's the whole point of the project. So it just, you know, that's, I've never asked for anything, but I have. For this thing, I'm prepared to ask, because I want to see this happen, and I want to try and get this book out in a year. The words of support and messages that I got from so many young people since we started the campaign is amazing. It really touched my heart, because this is my own project. I've been working on it. I never knew whether anyone could make sense of it, let alone me. And the thing is, I spent a lot of time de-Arabizing it, because as Muslims we tend to talk in our own language, inshallah, mashallah, alhamdulillah. That's a language we understand, no one else understands that language. So I had to go through the text and de-Arabize it. I did a real test. I said to friends of mine, I want you to find me somebody who knows nothing about Islam, who knows nothing about Sufism, and I want them to read the book. And they found me a school teacher in America, and I sent her the book. She read it, she said, I love it. I said, that's all I want. If you understand it, then anybody can understand it. This is important.
Okay, I think we've got time for about one more question. I'm going to go to the lady just on the left-hand side of the room here, member of the door. Thank you.
Thank you very much for sharing all your work. I've been trying to catch you for so many years, but never had the chance. I agree with you, your work is really, really inspiring. It's nice when you're in a monotony of dunya, basically, to break it up. Obviously, you've had years and years of experience and such knowledge in your stories. Which experience has impacted you the most, or out of all these decades of meeting people, which one really touched your heart the most?
It would be the most, that's the most impossible question to answer. Because I'm a sum total of all these meetings and things that have happened to me, and they're all significant. You know, when you look back at your life, everything that happened to you is significant. And sometimes terrible things happen to you, and at the time you may never understand them. But years later you'll say, that's why that happened. That's why that had to happen, so that I might learn something or to push me in another direction. You know, things happen. I've had all my money stolen. Things like happen, and you think, why did that happen? But then it's just to push you on, to stop you. You know, there are things happen. We don't know. We just have to trust that it's all part of the, you know, the journey that we're on. And so, and each one of you, this is not, every one of you is on your own journey. And it's a great blessing. Don't undertake it, you know, misundertake it. It's a big thing. And life is, it happens in a flash. You know, the famous thing that the Prophet ﷺ said, I am like a traveler who takes shade under a tree only to carry on, you know, continue the journey. He saw this life just as brief as that, as like a resting time under the shade of a tree. Because this is just part of the long journey that we're all on. This isn't it. It started before this and it continues this and it goes on forever. So, just, you know, grab as many gifts as you can.
Okay, thank you.
Can I just say that please, the campaign is still going, even though we've reached our target. There was like about 8,000 pounds of card errors, so it's actually isn't quite as high as it is on the launch campaign. And then if someone pays, it doesn't readjust it. So it's actually, I don't know what the true figure is, but I set 50,000 because I don't know how much this thing's going to cost. It could cost more than that. Whatever it is, the money will be ring marked. It's going to go in a separate account for Meetings of Mountains. I won't touch it. It's nothing to do with my business. This money is surely for this project. And anything that comes out, whether we do exhibitions, I want to do as much. Please spread, even if you can't give money, just spread the word. I need to find people who know about publishers, because if you don't get the publisher I want, I need to talk to other publishers. So anybody who can help in that, anybody who can help marketing this project, please help me. I think it's important. God knows best, but it's our last chance. Before we die under Trumpism or ISISism and all these things, all this negative stuff that's going on in the world. When you're with these people, you forget about all this. They're just positive. They don't allow negative thoughts into their hearts. They don't allow fear into their hearts. That's it. That's the message. Shaitan is fear, really. He rules our lives. Don't let him. One of the great scholars said, busy yourself with a friend, not the enemy. I mean, always remember God, forget about Shaitan. If you busy yourself with him, he'll occupy your life. Simple messages, really. Thank you for coming. I really am honored that you all came, really. And let's see if we can get a tipping point with this and show people the true face of Islam, really.